My name is Pedro Lopes from the University of Chicago, and today I'd like to talk to you about a reflection paper that this very group of people that stand here in this slide, my co-authors and I, did about a paradigm shift in our thinking about interfaces. We used to thinking of HCI as the study of the interaction between humans and computers. This perspective of interaction makes us consider users and devices as two separate entities, the user and the device that I represent here on these bubbles. Now, this separation has proven very valuable since the early days of interactive computing, and this is what allowed us to move from mainframes to personal computers, by improving the interaction between the user and device by, for instance, optimizing the input device's bandwidth and its ergonomics. Then, trying to make these interactions happen everywhere and anytime led to flipping of the form factor of the interactive devices, with now the device being smaller than its user. As we know, this led to mobile devices and to a proliferation in our analysis of the interactions with these devices, fueled by the need of solutions to new modalities, to smaller devices, things like touch. And this pretty much ended up putting an interactive device in almost everyone's pocket. As this need for interactions everywhere grew and grew, it moved the devices from the user's pocket closer to the user's body in the form of wearable devices, which, as we know, can be attached to the user's body or embedded in your clothing. This, of course, also brought itself a new set of challenges, such as how to interact ice-free when moving or in really quick bursts of interaction. Now, this way of thinking of the letter I in HCI as interaction is very powerful, and it draws on the very definition of the word, communication with someone or something. And it's precisely that we as researchers are often optimizing. We're optimizing the speed of the communication, the bandwidth of the communication between the user and the device. But today, I want to emphasize that there's a new interface paradigm in the horizon just after wearable devices, and that these devices overlap with the human body to a much larger degree than ever before. Let me exemplify this using something that is very close to my heart: interactive devices based on electrical muscle stimulation. These have the capability of moving the user's muscles involuntarily. As such, by just activating these electrodes, one can turn your muscles into a display by controlling the way you sketch. Now here, what is really striking is that the user's muscles are an integral part of the hardware of the device. And that's why we say that there's a large overlap between the user and the device. As a result of this overlap, we really think it will be productive to think of the letter I in HCI not just as of interaction, but also as of integration. And that this paradigm shift is not just limited to devices that overlap with the user's muscles, but even with implanted devices. These are devices that are completely inside the user's body, usually devices from the medical realm, such as pacemakers and RFIDs, but as we'll see, also some interactive devices. So we think this perspective of integration can be very useful to explore the fusion of the boundaries between users and devices, and maybe even uncover challenges that only arise if you consider these two entities, user and device, as one integrated entity. So that's precisely what we did. We immersed 29 researchers for 5 days in Dachstuhl in Germany to discuss the grand challenges that come with integration of devices and users. We wanted to find out which issues are exacerbated when looking at HCI from the perspective of integration. And we clustered these issues in what we think are grand challenges for the field. And these are organized in 4 categories: human-compatible technology, identity and behavior, integration with society, and designing for integrated interfaces. Now, I can't dive into all of these challenges right here in this format, so let me highlight 2 key challenges that I think are especially relevant for future interfaces that integrate directly with the body. Now, let me start with biocompatibility, and I truly mean it in the broader possible sense of the word. Here, we're departing from rigid wearable devices that just sit loosely in your skin, and we're diving directly into attaching or sticking devices that are made of films or electrodes into the user's epidermis. What really sets these epidermal devices apart from wearables is that they're made to adapt to the user's body shape by engineering them out of flexible or stretchable materials. Now, sometimes parts of our research devices might accomplish this goal, but they still hide away pieces of electronics that are ultimately comprised of non-stretchable or non-conformable material. The reason why we think this is a grand challenge rather than a ordinary challenge is that we don't just mean to conform the sensor or the actuators to the skin, as is the case here, but to go further and conform the complete device to the body. And we're seeing a range of ways to approach this still open challenge, from devices that do not have a rigid printed circuit board to stretchable transistors. Now, the next type of devices are placed under the user's epidermis and are therefore literally under your skin. These are fingertip magnets, RFID implants, and even some more complex interactive devices. Lastly, at the last layer, as you move past the skin and into the fat and the tissue, you have truly implanted devices such as cochlear implants, insulin pumps, and pacemakers. Now, if we look at each of these layers of the stack, we see different key challenges for HCI researchers. Devices attached to the skin directly do not require any surgery or complex procedure because they are based on stickers, like the sticky electrodes of muscle stimulation. On the contrary, this means that these stickers obstruct the skin. They interfere heavily with your tactile acuity and they diminish your dexterity. And of course, they are not permanent, so they need to be constantly reapplied. This is a key limitation because while these are the safest devices in this list, they're actually the only one that only has applications in research right now. Now, subdermal devices are a different class. They require small surgical procedures to go into your epidermis. These devices allow for permanent application of simple actuators, such as magnets in your fingertips or RFIDs in your hand. But as they grow in complexity, such as this device here with LEDs and batteries by Tim Cannon, well, there's a whole new range of open challenges. How do you upgrade the device? How do you communicate without cables and open wounds that might get infected and so forth? And of course, due to the deeper level implantation, these truly implanted devices, such as pacemakers, inherit the challenges from all the layers above with an extra level of critical care. That's biocompatibility of the materials to avoid rejection and toxicity, and of course, the need for serious surgery. They of course have their benefits, right? Lifelong permanence, access to organs, not just to sensory apparatus, that's how a pacemaker is able to regulate your heart function, and they usually don't actually need any explicit user involvement. Most of them just do their thing automatically. And so while these are certainly implanted devices, they are not really interactive implanted devices, as they don't right now expose an interface to the user. So it's an open challenge how you might allow your users to control or interact with such devices. Now, I've talked about challenges down at the intersection of hardware and users' biology and their skin, but how do these integrated devices might affect identity and behavior? The big open question here is, if you've integrated with a device to a point that, as I just told you, the device maybe sits well inside your body and it acts through a very direct means of interaction, such as muscle movement, what does this do to your sense of self? Right, in other words, if there's an interface paradigm shift towards integrated devices, is there also a shift in the perception of self? And technologies for changing one's perception of self are out there. In fact, virtual reality has been a rather popular means to achieve many of these illusions, such as the shift one's perspective into that of a child with a smaller body. And certainly it's even possible to do that outside of the black box of VR. Here's a user that sees from a viewpoint of a camera attached to their waist, and as my postdoc Jun Nishida found out, users not only see from the height of a child, their behavior is somewhat transformed into that of an actual child. Now, these devices do this by tricking our optical sense, but as this integration moves further from the user senses into the actual user's actuators, like their muscles, self-perception changes even more because we can now manipulate self-action. For example, in one of my early projects using muscle stimulation, I created a variation of a popular children's game called Red Hands or Slapsies, in which two people are playing and one tries to slap and the other tries to avoid, here played by one player. Now here the trick is that your involuntary hand is controlled by means of muscle stimulation, and you're trying to avoid with the hand that is under your control. When my participants tried this out, what happened is that they reported a sense of blurred ownership, sometimes referring to their computer-controlled hand as part of their own body and sometimes as an interactive device that they just played a game with, almost outside of themselves. This is even more evident as we start to give users abilities beyond their biological capacity. For example, here we're using muscle stimulation to accelerate someone's reaction time so much that they're able to take a picture of this fast-moving baseball. And this kind of counters your intuition, because my intuition would be to say that if I would feel the complete sense of agency, the sense of I did this, and that sense is totally immutable when I'm doing a voluntary action. So if I'm taking the picture by myself, I will feel maximum agency. But if anything or any device helps me to do that faster than humanly possible, for instance, by assistance, by means of electrical muscle stimulation, I would feel absolutely no feeling of agency. But our findings were actually quite different. What we saw is that users actually felt completely in control of actions that were still performed faster and could only be performed at that speed by means of muscle stimulation. And in fact, there are many, many other devices out there that can achieve this kind of assisted control, such as extra limbs that hold tools for you, or muscle stimulation that makes you operate a tool that you've never used before, or even a tail that automatically balances your body. Now, these exhibit varying levels of agency, from user-driven to kind of mixed initiative to things that just automatically do their thing. And as such, different balances between this user and device agency might yield very different perceptions in their users, such as, I did this, or this made me do it, or this helped me. And we think this is really a grand open challenge for devices that have the ability to control the user's body. How are you going to design your interfaces to have this mixed initiative and mixed agency? Now, what's also more striking about the perception of self is that it's influenced by how others see us. And as such, the open challenge here is also to examine the perception of these integrated devices on others. For example, how will others perceive you when you have a robotic tail like this one, or this interactive tail made by our co-author Doc? And in fact, some researchers, such as Christian Holtz and his colleagues, have explicitly looked at how users of mock-up implanted devices felt as they walked around their surroundings using these devices, in fact, around bystanders. And so we think is a real key challenge to deepen our understanding of the future of these devices to understand how they impact the user and the users around them. Now, let me summarize. I presented the grand challenges that we derived by looking at HCI as integration rather than as interaction. These was clustered in four categories that you see right here. And I also want to emphasize that while I didn't get into all of them in this talk, this is really the kind of paper that you should really read and dissect and disagree with. As a paper co-authored by 26 people, I also don't agree with all the perspectives in it, and we really meant this paper as a conversation starter. Now, if you find yourself saying HCI but meaning something else than our existing HCI acronym, and you're getting confused with integration and interaction, don't worry. We're not necessarily trying to overload our very useful term. In fact, most of us refer to human-computer integration as HINT and not as HCI. Now, of course, some of us went all the way with it, such as myself, and I decided to call my HCI lab the Human-Computer Integration Lab. So we're also trying to provoke more researchers to consider this perspective when they're actually just doing their research at every moment, and sometimes thinking and considering users and devices as one integrated entity might be very, very useful for your own research. Lastly, I really want to thank my amazing co-authors, and especially I want to thank Floyd, Jonathan, and Patty for bringing us all together and writing up this paper. And I'd love to hear more of your questions. Send me an email.